Hi everyone, I'm here with Iain, and what is your role at Tait, Iain?
Hi there, I'm a senior design engineer at Tait Electronics. I work on the network infrastructure products at Tait. I look after what's called the node, and I'm going to explain today why we have one of these in the Tier 2 network.
Okay, so you are the right person to explain the Tait DMR Tier 2 multi-site network. And you've painstakingly drawn this thing for us. Could you just kind of explain what all's going on here?
Okay, so we'll start at the beginning with Tier 2. You basically need some mobiles or terminals, and they'll talk to a site somewhere. So this is your typical single site DMR Tier 2 network.
Okay.
This is our Tier 2 base station. You have some sort of combiner, antenna, and the radios can talk backwards and forward. In the real world, this gives you a small coverage area, so they want more coverage. You want to have multi-sites, so you want to be able to have radios at one part of your city or somewhere else talk to radios way over on a different site. So what I've drawn here is one site here and these other sites over here. This is the same thing. You have base station, combiner gear, and antennas, and you'll have mobiles and radios talking here. Now, with Tier 2, this is just like Tier 3. Everything's connected using IP, so audio comes in into the base station, gets converted into packets, and they get sent via IP through to the rest of the system. Now, in our Tier 2 solution, we've provided a node which does lots of clever stuff.
Okay, so it's interesting that we have a node here for the DMR Tier 2 network. Why do we have a node?
So there's a lot of reasons we have a node in our system.
Because not everyone has a node in their system. Right,
no.
Okay.
So a lot of other solutions, they have basically site controllers, and these guys will talk to each other and work out who should be talking, who's allowed to talk. So in our solution, we've moved that sort of complexity into the node. So it's all in one place. Now, the advantage it gives us with that is we have much better control of the floor, who's talking. We can now hook up all sorts of interfaces as well. It makes it a lot easier. So the main one that people want is the dispatch consoles. So in this case, these consoles only have to talk to one node. You don't have to have these hooked up to base stations. It means that in terms of IP connections, they're not going up links up to hills or things like that. They can just talk to a node, which would be in some central point, which makes it a lot easier to set up. Now, if you know anything about Tier 3, then this is all exactly the same in Tier 2. We have all the same interfaces that we have in Tier 3. So we get a voice recorder, so we can record everything that's happening on the system. We have everything can be configured through the web, so you can use any computer to configure our system. Now, all the other interfaces you also get now are phone calls. You can make phone calls through the system. This uses SIP. So it's a common interface for talking to phone connections. We've got an AVL interface, so you can monitor what all the radios in your system are doing. Standard stuff like SMP and syslogs you get for free with Tier 2. We have interfaces that provide call records, statistics, and all of these can be fed using JSON out to customer applications. So this makes it really flexible for the customers. They have all sorts of information available if they want it. If they just want a basic Tier 2, then you don't have to use these extra interfaces.
Okay. So last question. What areas do I need to consider when provisioning connectivity for the network?
So in this diagram, I've sort of drawn this cloud. But in reality, from your site back to some central point, generally, you're going to have some sort of link. Now, the way you provide these links, there's so many different ways. So this is all standard IP stuff. So this is your link. It provides your IP backbone between your base station and the rest of the system. And typical things here are microwave links, E1 T1 links. You could even have copper and all that sort of stuff. We do have limitations on how much we have to pass through the system. Now, in terms of the capacity that we need on this link, we've got a technical note that explains all the details of it, but the simple one is that you need 64 kilobits per second for each base station you want at a site, be able to provide the packets through the system.
Okay. All right, well, Iain, thank you for giving us the lay of the land for a DMR Tier 2 multi-site network.